Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Welcome to the house of the Lord this morning. May you be blessed as we worship together. And welcome to those who are viewing this online. May you also be blessed. May I ask you please to stand as Sandy brings the Bible into our midst. All that we do in our worship service is based on the good book. Please be seated. Our call to worship this morning, I'm reading from Psalm 116, verses 1 to 7. I love the Lord, for he heard my voice. He heard my cry for mercy, because he turned his ear to me. I will call on him as long as I live. The cords of death entangled me. The anguish of the grave came over me. I was overcome by distress and sorrow. Then I called on the name of the Lord. Lord, save me. The Lord is gracious and righteous. Our God is full of compassion. The Lord protects the unwary. When I was brought low, he saved me. Return to your rest, my soul, for the Lord has been good to you. Let us pray. Merciful and loving God, glory, honor, and praise to you as we come together this morning and worship you as our Lord God Almighty. You alone are the one who gives us rest for our souls. You are always there to call on, and you always hear us when we call on you. When we gaze on the wonders of this earth and marvel at your creation, we sometimes feel small and insignificant, and yet you know us intimately and love us unconditionally. How marvelous you are. We confess, Lord, that we do not always follow you as we should. We forget our great commission to love you with all our heart, soul, and mind, and love others as we love ourselves. Forgive us, Lord. May we find healing in your grace and mercy, and be refreshed to follow you more closely. Thank you that your word declares that if we confess our sins, that you are faithful and just, and will forgive us our sins and purify us all from unrighteousness. In the loving name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Now we're going to stand and sing two choruses.
Thank you.
Okay, kids. We've got a kid's story. Who wants to come? Okay, kids. So, I have a video to show you. But before we see the video, I want to ask you a question. If you're a little bit naughty at home, and your mum or dad catch you, and you say sorry, what do they say? Do they say, no, I don't think you're sorry. I don't believe you're sorry. Go away. Do they say that? What do they say? It's okay. I forgive you. Thank you for saying sorry. Well, we're going to see a story today about an unforgiving servant. So if you watch the screen up there, Uncle Bob's going to put it on.
Stories of the Bible. Of the unforgiving servant. This is Jesus, who is the Son of God and the Savior of the world. While Jesus was on earth, he taught everyone about God's love and healed people from their sickness. He did many miracles like walking on water.
Oh, hang on.
And even raised people from the dead. One day, Jesus was talking with his disciples and teaching them when Peter asked,
Jira?
How often should I forgive someone who sins against me? 7 times? Jesus said, no, not 7 times, but 70 times 7. Then Jesus told a parable. He said, the kingdom of heaven can be compared to a king who decided to get his money back that he had let his servants borrow. While the king was doing this, one of the servants who owed him $1 million was brought in.
$1 million, please?
The servant couldn't pay, so the king ordered that he be sold, along with his family and everything he owned, to pay the debt.
Wait, please!
But the servant begged the king, please be patient with me, and I will pay it all. Then his king was filled with pity for him, and he let him go and forgave his debt. But when the man left the king, he went to a fellow servant who owed him a few $1,000s.
Hi?
Come here, you.
He grabbed him and demanded that he pay him back immediately.
Oh, wait, please.
His fellow servant begged for a little more time. He said, be patient with me and I will pay it.
No.
But the servant wouldn't wait. He had the man arrested and put in prison until the debt could be paid in full. When some of the other servants saw this, they were very upset. They went to the king and told him everything that had happened. Then the king called in the man he had forgiven and said, you evil servant, I forgave you that tremendous debt because you pleaded with me. Shouldn't you have mercy on your fellow servant, just as I had mercy on you? Then the angry king sent the man to prison to be punished until he had paid all that he owed. Jesus then said, that's what my heavenly Father will do to you if you refuse to forgive your brothers and sisters from your heart.
So what did you think of that? Was he a nice servant? What did he do wrong? So he went to the king and he said, I can't pay you any money. And the king forgave him, didn't he? Gave him that massive amount of debt. And then he went and saw someone that owed him money. And what did he do to him? He didn't want to forgive him, did he? No. He said, no, you pay me the money. But the king got to hear of it, and he ended up in jail. So when your brothers or your sisters or your friends do something wrong, and they say, I'm so sorry, what do you do? Forgive them. That's it. Now, I think you might be going out to Sunday school. Okay. Go back and sit with Mum and Dad, or whoever you're with. Thank you for coming and listening to my story. I hope the big kids enjoyed it too. We're now going to sing another song. We're going to sing This Is the Day. Please be seated. Norm and Tom, would you like to take up our free will offering, please? I'd like to give you an opportunity to share with the congregation anything where you've noticed God working in your lives this last week or past whatever. And then Mike will bring us the message.
The first reading is from Matthew 18, verse 21 to 35. Then Peter came to Jesus and asked, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Up to seven times? Jesus answered, I tell you, not seven times, but 77 times. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 bags of gold was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and his children and all he had be sold to repay the debt. At this, the servant fell on his knees before him, said, Be patient with me, he begged, and I will pay back everything. The servant's master took pity on him, cancelled the debt, and let him go. But when the servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 silver coins. He grabbed him and began to choke him. Pay back what you owe me, he demanded. His fellow servant fell to his knees and begged him, Be patient with me and I will pay it back. But he refused. Instead, he went off and had the man thrown into prison until he could pay the debt. When the other servants saw what happened, they were outraged and went and told their master everything that had happened. Then the master called the servant in. You wicked servant, he said. I cancelled all the debts of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I had on you? In anger, his master handed him over to the jailers to be tortured until he should pay back all he owed. This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother or sister from your heart. This is the word of God.
And I'm reading from Romans 14, 1 to 12. Accept him whose faith is weak, without passing judgment on disputable matters. One man's faith allows him to eat everything, but another man whose faith is weak eats only vegetables. The man who eats everything must not look down on him who does not, and the man who does not eat everything must not condemn the man who does, for God has accepted him. Who are you to judge someone else's servant? To his own master he stands or falls, and he will stand, for the Lord is able to make him stand. One man considers one day more sacred than another. Another man considers every day alike. Each one should be fully convinced in his own mind. He who regards one day as special does so to the Lord. He who eats meat eats to the Lord, for he gives thanks to God. And he who abstains does so to the Lord and gives thanks to God. For none of us lives to himself alone, and none of us dies to himself alone. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. For this very reason Christ died and returned to life, so that he might be the Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you judge your brother? Or why do you look down on your brother? For we will all stand before God's judgment seat. It is written, as surely as I live, says the Lord, every knee will bow before me, every tongue will confess to God. So then each of us will give an account of himself to God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. How many times should I forgive the person who has sinned against me? It's a fair question. I think it's safe to say that everybody here today has been hurt or sinned against in some way in their lives. Someone has hurt you or wronged you. Maybe not intentionally, but you felt it. Somebody may have actually deliberately hurt you, and you struggle with the idea of forgiving them. See, it's much easier to forgive somebody who didn't mean to do it. And sometimes when you let somebody know that something they did has deeply hurt you, and it would horrify them, they think, oh, I'm so sorry, I didn't realize what I'd done and how it affected you. So you can put that behind them there and forgive their ignorance, so to speak. But what about those who have deeply hurt you and sinned against you, but they just don't care? Or they don't think they've done anything wrong. Or worse, they make it your fault. It's really hard to forgive them. And maybe we're not sure that we really want to forgive them. And we might reason, well, they don't deserve to be forgiven. They're not repentant. Why should they be forgiven? Or if they apologize and come and say, I'm so sorry, I shouldn't have done what I've done, then I will forgive them. It's a bit hard when that person might have died or you never have contact with them anymore. So how easy it is to justify our unforgiveness. So Peter asked the question, how many times should I forgive the person who sinned against me? Seven times? But what Jesus does is put it in a kingdom of God perspective. It's not just about how many times. And that's why he tells the story. You see, while it's true that the person does not deserve to be forgiven, we need to keep in mind that we too have sinned and wronged others, particularly God, and we don't deserve to be forgiven either. So that's when Jesus proceeds to tell the story. And we saw that lovely cartoon version. And simply the man who owed $1 million, in the text it says 100 bags of gold. That's a huge amount of money. And he begs for time to pay, but you see, realistically, he couldn't pay it back. He's virtually bankrupt. In other words, he hasn't got the resources to pay his debt. But the king, in his compassion, forgives him the whole thing. But then in contrast, he has a friend who owes him a much smaller amount of money, who also begs for time to pay, which he could do, but he refuses to forgive. And that's when Jesus said, "This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother or sister from your heart." Now, the point here is that God has forgiven us. He's cancelled our debt. Not just given us time to pay it off. We have been pardoned. The debt has been wiped out. See, the biblical understanding of forgiveness is our starting point here. Not whether the person is guilty or even repentant, but that we who have sinned against God have been forgiven much. I don't want to get on too many sidetracks, but one of the problems today in trying to tell people how much they need Jesus is they don't think they need forgiveness. They don't need salvation. I'm not a sinner, because the society has redefined sin so much that they think, I haven't done anything. I haven't killed anybody. And even if I did, they probably deserved it. So how we justify ourselves. There's a story, I'm sure you've heard it. It's an old story of a little boy who was naughty a lot. And his father, to point out how often he'd sinned and wronged, he put a nail in the shed door. And after a while, the door was full of nails. And the dad looked at it and thought, well, that's a bit much. It's probably causing the boy to feel a lot of guilt. So he said, as an act of forgiveness, he pulled all the nails out of the door. But they noticed that every nail had left a nail hole, a scar. They were a reminder that a sin had been committed but forgiven. In the sense, the nail marks in Jesus' hands and body are an eternal reminder that we have sinned against God and yet we've been forgiven. The scars are a reminder of the cost of our forgiveness. Not a record of our sin or who committed the sin, but sin has consequences. Now, this forgiveness of God is not a New Testament phenomena. Forgiveness is something deep in the Old Testament. Jeremiah 31:34 says, "From the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord, I will forgive their wickedness and remember their sins no more." God is going to wipe it clean. don't know if those of you old enough to remember, long time ago before internet shopping and credit cards, the local shop, corner shop, would allow a certain amount of credit. And they'd keep on a chalkboard or a slate a record. So it'd say, Mrs. Fawcett, and she owed £1, 10 shillings. Now, in those days, that was a lot of money. Okay. And then when payday came, she'd go and she'd paid off. And what they did, they got a rubber and they rubbed it out. The debt was wiped clear. The slate was cleared. And that's where you get the phrase, slate has been cleaned. The debt's been wiped out. And in Psalm 103, verse 12, it says, as far as the east is from the west, so far I have removed your sins from you. That's very significant. As far as the east is from the west. If it said north, south, if you head north, you come to a point where you can't go any further north and you start going south. That's, unless the earth's flat, then you're in trouble. Excuse me. But if you just travel east, you never stop going east. So east and west never connect, not like north and south. You never stop. That's as far away as God has separated our sins from us. You know, over the years, there's been many scandals in the church, and church leaders, evangelists, and priests have committed serious sin. And it's deeply hurt the Christian church. But I believe at least equal damage and deeper wounds, it's not this, so much the Catholic priests who have abused children, as serious as that is, that's not to diminish that in any way. But the many Christians who have held resentment against other Christians and deep unforgiveness, and how that has become known in a community, and the damage that's done to the church and the Christian faith. Now that, I think that's serious. And I hear many times people tell me in the community, non-Christians, I know these guys, and they're churchgoers, they're Christians, and the things they do to each other and the things they've done just puts me off seriously. And I say, how can Christianity be true if those men who claim to be Christians can do that? I mean, what do you say to that? It's true. You can say, but that's not right. They're in the wrong. And it stopped. It becomes a stumbling block that stops people finding God's love and forgiveness in the community. And Paul tells us in Romans 14, a very important verse towards the end, that each of us will give an account of our lives before God. Yes, we are forgiven. And just as Jesus said, you've been forgiven, but how you treat others after that, Jesus takes note of. Have you forgiven as freely as you have been forgiven? So Jesus makes it clear that no one who refuses to give their brother or sister or neighbor will be declared innocent. But in saying this, we may find that it's not so much a refusal to forgive we find too hard. It's just that it's difficult to forgive. Is there someone that's really hurt you and sinned against you? It sometimes it feels like they've put a hook in your heart. And they may be long gone. You may never have any contact, but like they're an intimate part of your life because they have hooked into your heart. you're painfully linked together. Forgiveness is unhooking them. Not condoning what they did in any way. It's not even forgetting what they did. It's saying, forgiveness is essentially saying, I give up the right to punish and condemn them, and we're handing them to God. They have to stand before God to give an account of themselves to him. So we're handing over judgment. And in actual fact, it sets us free. There's evidence to show, and all kinds of research, that unforgiveness actually hurts us far more than the person we're unable to forgive. I have some personal experiences with that, which I won't go into for time. See, we can focus on the offence against them, which means that person is defined by the offence. And the person's overshadowed by that event. A quick example of that is, and I've encountered this, person comes out of jail. Person was, might be a doctor, for say, a doctor. In a period of time before they committed a crime, they were had healed and helped many people. But when they're charged and come out of jail, they're an ex-con. They're a thief or an embezzler. That's what defines them from there on. The fact that they've done lots of good things in their life is now put in the background. And it's the same when somebody's sinned against us, forever they will be whatever it was they did to us. When we set them free, when we hand them over to God and forgive them, they become another person, a sinner, just like us. There may be a wound or a scar, just as Jesus still carries the nail marks in his hands and feet, and the spear mark in his side, the marks on his head from the crown of thorns. See, the thorns are no more. The spear has long since perished, along with the nails. Jesus doesn't remember who did this to him, only that a sinner was forgiven. From the cross he prayed, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." I mentioned earlier about the difficulty many face in forgiving, especially if that offence is very significant and leaves deep, lasting scars on our lives. How do we deal with that? And I think just you need to be clear about Jesus' words when he said, God will not hold innocent the person that refuses to forgive in their heart. Now, sometimes it's not a matter of refusing to forgive, but we struggle for years over, I find it hard to forgive what they did. I'd like to let it go, but I can't. And I've counseled many, many people over the years who struggled with that. And you know, often, who's the hardest person to forgive? Yourself. When you're haunted by your own guilt, things you've done, and it haunts you. Like what David was saying on the video earlier, those who were here, Satan picks that up and he keeps reminding you of what you did. We need to remember that forgiveness isn't just a single event, it's a process. If the intention is, I want to forgive. I want to be obedient to God and forgive that person, but it's hard. Think of it as a process. The key, and this is the key to forgiving others, remember that through the cross you have been forgiven and pardoned, like the guy that owed much. Secondly, look beyond the person's sin and offence and try to see them as God sees them and focus on the person, not the hurt. And then you discover someone just like you, imperfect, vulnerable, needing love and forgiveness. I remember hearing some time ago the term, hurt people hurt people. Hurt people hurt people. People are hurting others because they've been hurt. Remember Jesus' words to the crowd when they brought an adulterous woman to him? He said, let him or them who are without sin cast the first stone. What happened? They gradually dropped their rocks and walked away. And the other important thing is to acknowledge the hurt. This is important. Forgiveness is not denial. Forgiveness is not pretending the offense didn't happen. It's not saying they're now innocent, they never did anything wrong. Excuse me. It's like the nail marks in the door, the scars in Jesus' hand. Sins can leave a scar. There's a consequence to sinning. Excuse me. When Jesus looks at you and me, he doesn't see a sinner. He sees someone in need of forgiveness and salvation. He sees someone God loves so much. When God looks at you, he sees someone he loves so much that he was prepared to sacrifice his precious only son that you might be forgiven and have eternal life. Not just to give you time to work out your salvation, to give you time to be good and earn your place in heaven. You've received a pardon, like that old corner shop slate. The slate is wiped clean and you are set free. And Jesus said, as I have forgiven you, so you ought to forgive one another. Let's pray. Lord, words alone are not enough to say thank you for all that you've done, for the forgiveness that you've granted us, for the salvation you've secured for us. So may our lives express our gratitude. And Lord, help us as we have received our forgiveness to share that love and to pass that love unto others, to forgive them as they, as you have forgiven us. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to sing a song. I think you'll know it. Freely, freely you have received. God forgave my sin. Let's stand and sing. God forgave my sin.
To share his love.
As we prepare to come to the Lord's table, we're going to share in a declaration of our common faith. So let's say this together. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, the Maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through thing for us men and women, for our salvation, came down from heaven by the power. Under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and Son, in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, we acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Friends, this is the table of the Lord. And in this sacrament of his broken body and outpoured blood, the risen Lord feeds his baptized people on their way to the final inheritance of the kingdom. And through faith and the gift of the Holy Spirit, we have communion with our Savior and we make our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. We proclaim the Lord's death. We grow together into Christ. And we are strengthened for our participation in the mission of Christ in the world. And we rejoice in the foretaste of the kingdom which he will bring to consummation. We have another song we're going to sing. And the song, I hope you know it, is Take Our Bread, We Ask You. Take our lives, we love you. I invite you to stand as we sing this.
Thank you. standing washed in your blood. Spirit filled and hungry, we are your food. You built ourselves the best that we could. We are yours.
We are yours.
We are your bread. We ask you to take our blood.
We love you to take our blood. Oh, Father, we are yours. Take our bread. We ask you to take our blood. We love you to take our blood. Oh, Father, we are yours. We are yours.
Please be seated. In obedience to Jesus' command, in remembrance of him who on the night he was betrayed, he took the bread and the wine and he set them apart from everyday use and he blessed them as we do that. And he invited us to do this in remembrance of him. And he said, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." And as Jesus gave thanks and blessed, let us come before God in our prayer of thanksgiving. Our Father, we give you thanks for all that you are. We thank you for the creation in which we live. We thank you for the lives that you've blessed us with, the families and friends, this community. But we thank you most of all for the gift of Jesus, who lived a life, a human life, with all its struggles and pains, with all its disappointments and sorrows and joys. And yet he lived in full obedience to you. We thank you most of all for his death on the cross, which secures our salvation and forgiveness, for his glorious resurrection, which means, Lord, you live with us forever. We thank you for the promise that one day you will return and restore all things. So, Lord, receive ourselves and these elements of bread and wine as we do this in remembrance of you. And as Jesus taught his disciples to pray, let's say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And according to this holy institution, we do as Jesus commanded, when on the night of he was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body, given for you." And after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks and blessed it, and said, "This cup is a new covenant shed out for you, of the blood of Jesus shed for you for the forgiveness of sins." In other words, our forgiveness cost God dearly. So drink of it, all of you, and receive in your heart a renewal of forgiveness and love from Jesus. So let us draw near in faith, receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, his blood, which he shed for you, and eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts with faith and thanksgiving. Do we have some people to help serve? The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ. The body of Christ given for you and the blood of Christ shed for you, may it secure you in eternal life. Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, for this time of refreshing, of a reminder of the cost of our salvation. As we have received, help us to freely give. And Lord, as we have taken these elements, strengthen us in our hands in faith to serve others as you have served us. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Bob, would you like to come forward for the prayers of intercession, please? We're now going to stand and sing our final song. And as you sing this song, I really want you to prayerfully sing it, because I hope this song takes you into the week. It's Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus, because it doesn't matter what happens in our lives. If we turn our eyes upon Jesus, it will give us the hope and the joy and the peace that only the Lord can give. So please stand and sing with me. The love of the Lord Jesus draw you to himself. The power of the Lord Jesus strengthen you in his service. The joy of the Lord Jesus fill your hearts. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Please remain standing as Sandy takes the word into our new week. May the Lord go before us and be beside us and be our rear guard.